CHAPTER 22 of Miss Pym's Camouflage. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Miss Pym's Camouflage by Lady Dorothy Stanley. CHAPTER 22. Miss Pym, without any special precautions to move noiselessly, walked up to the bedside and took up the Kaiser's ring, which she ran on to her left thumb. Then swiftly she returned to the foot of the bed. The world would be well rid of this monster, and she must be the instrument of its deliverance. Taking the revolver out of her bag, she calmly eyed the All Highest. He was sitting up, alert. He had heard some movement in the room. "He shall see me. I will not shoot unseen," thought Miss Pym. Then, straightening herself till she felt the short spinal spasm, she reappeared and covered the Kaiser with the automatic. "You abject villain," she cried, "prepare to die," and fired. But there was only a click. Perhaps the first shot had been spent. Miss Pym, thoroughly roused, clicked the pistol again and again, then hurled it at the Kaiser, who was yelling to the guard. He had thrown himself out of bed, and was dodging about the room as Miss Pym kept getting between him and the door. She had no sooner flung away the pistol than the tall Jaeger rushed in, followed by other attendants. In a flash Miss Pym became invisible, but her excitement was so great she feared that the beating of her heart would betray her presence. The Kaiser, still shaking, recovered his dignity with an effort. Seating himself on the bed, he directed his servants to search every corner and cupboard. When Anton appeared in a huge motor coat and goggles, Miss Pym's emotion took the form of laughter, which she could not stop. It was so wild and uncanny that everyone stood as though petrified. "You hear that, Anton?" said the Kaiser. "It is the mad Englishwoman." "What Englishwoman?" "As soon as you left, a woman dressed in black from head to foot crept up to this bed and fired at me repeatedly, or rather attempted to fire, but the pistol appears not to have been loaded. She then hurled it at me." "Yes, there it is," as one of the servants picked up the pistol. "You see, this is no dream, no disordered fancy. Besides, you heard that hyena laugh. She must be hidden somewhere." Miss Pym edged along to a door, opened it gently, and slipped into a large dark room. She felt her way along by the wall on the left till she came to a door locked inside. Turning the key very softly, she let herself out into the corridor and descended the staircase. She must now commence the hunt for the papers. Which was the Kaiser's private sitting-room? She entered room after room, suites of empty, unlived-in apartments, and at last decided that the room she sought must be on the same floor as the bedchamber. Cautiously reascending, she peeped into many rooms, faintly illumined by the moon. At the end of the long passage she entered a fine library, somewhat after the English style. Switching on the electric light, she decided this must be the Kaiser's private sanctum. Bad works of art by himself, frightful designs in clay, photographs of children and grandchildren, but most of all, photographs of himself in every conceivable uniform, miniatures of himself painted on ivory, an oil portrait of the All Highest on his favorite charger. Certainly this was the Kaiser's room. Could it be doubted? She sat down at a beautiful writing-table with ormolu legs, and tried to open the drawers, which were locked. Taking off the ring, she turned the key out by a hinge, and the drawers opened. With feverish haste she looked through the papers, but they were mostly architectural plans by the Kaiser, mosques and Buddhist temples he intended building in the conquered East. Miss Pym, as she sat there, looked round the room for any likely places where the Kaiser might place his private correspondence. Her eyes fell on a tall cabinet of drawers, of an exquisite grain of mahogany, known as letter-wood, set in a lacework of gilded metal. The drawers were all fastened by a single band of wood running down the side, which was locked. The gold key opened this easily. The confining bar turned back on a hinge, and every drawer could be opened. Miss Pym pulled out one after another, and was rewarded by finding each drawer contained a year's most private and intimate correspondence, neatly tied up and docketed, every package dated. Hastily descending to the last five drawers, she emptied the contents onto the floor, closing each drawer as she emptied it. The last was only half full, and less orderly. She was standing there, wondering how to carry off all these papers, when she heard voices, and Anton entered with a tall young officer she had seen at mess. There was only one thing to do. Miss Pym subsided on the heap, just as a hen would over her chicks, all the papers disappearing, even as she herself had disappeared. Anton was perturbed. He sat on the edge of the table, somberly eyeing his big feet. The officer sat down in one of the large easy-chairs and lit a cigarette. "What do you think it all means?" he asked, striking a match. "Oh, I am hanged if I know," replied Anton, ruefully. "But this story of a woman all in black, what do you make of it?" continued the other. "Well, someone did laugh in that room, and a pistol was picked up. But it is one of our own service automatics, you know, and why shouldn't the old boy have thrown it there himself? As for the laugh, in the mood he is in, he would as soon laugh as shout. I think, Anton, the Kaiser has attacks of insanity." "Oh, do hold your tongue, as if there wasn't trouble enough. I have had such a beastly day. The people are just wild for food. I came from Berlin this afternoon. They were firing on the women in the streets. Some women threw themselves before the trains at the Lehrte station. I believe that lame devil Koitzik is at the bottom of all this trouble. He was at Cologne the other day, and tried to speak at the conference, urging the people to strike for peace, and do I know not what. Then he slipped away, but the police say he is hiding in Berlin. However, they'll get him 3 days hence. There is to be a big socialist gathering at which he is to speak, so we shall get him there, and he will be sent to the front." "What, that lame fellow?" "Yes, I believe he hobbles a bit. He will be trained for a week or so at the machine gun, and then, one fine day, our reformer will be put in the front trenches, chained by the leg to his gun, and good-bye, friend Koitzik. Well, I must be off. I return without the reprieve for that English girl. It is rather horrible, executing a woman for helping her lover to escape." "Is that so? Did the lover get clear away?" "Yes, and the poor wretch doesn't know the girl is to pay with her life for his escape. Everything is horrible, and my position of aide-de-camp to the Crown Prince is the most horrid of all." "Well, I am off," said Anton. "I hope the All-Highest won't break out again. You are here for tonight, so if the Englishwoman in black reappears, you will have to catch her and attend her execution." And readjusting his goggles, Anton and his friend went out, extinguishing the lights. Miss Pym sat there till all was quiet, then turning on the light, she examined the papers, but decided not to untie the packets. She spread a silken table cover on the floor, and placed the heap of papers in the center, and knotted up the corners of the silk. Then, shouldering this strange bundle, she walked quietly past the two guards, down the grand staircase to one of the farther apartments, where the furniture was shrouded in linen sheets, and lying down with the letter bundle for pillow, she slept uneasily, waking with heavy starts and sighs. Perhaps the contents of those letters exercised some baneful influence. Perhaps the thought of Koitzik's danger troubled her. But as the morning advanced, she slept better, and it was quite 9 o'clock before Miss Pym swung her feet to the floor and decided she badly needed breakfast. "It will go hard if I cannot find a breakfast and a bath in the new palace," thought Miss Pym. After much exploration, a very up-to-date bathroom was discovered, but the water was cold. However, a cold bath, with the thermometer rising to 80, was quite endurable, though Miss Pym always preferred hot water to cold. Refreshed, she made her way along the gallery of shells and mineralogical specimens to the kitchens, intent on hot coffee, real coffee, not the disgusting substitute, and real bread. It is only in Germany, thought Miss Pym, that one's mind keeps running on food. She found a stout German chef, very busy over the fristic, the early breakfast. Coffee was being poured boiling into silver jugs, with discreet little blue flames beneath. Footmen, with trays ready, waited for the hot milk which was palpitating in the great copper saucepans. Hot milk rolls, thin slices of ham, butter pats imprinted with the royal eagle, honey in the comb, dishes of smoked delicacies, and pâté de foie gras were allotted to each tray. As soon as the jugs of milk and coffee were placed on the tray, a footman snatched it up and disappeared. Miss Pym found it very difficult to grab a tray with one hand, as she could not relinquish the letter bundle, but she accomplished the feat and wandered off to the long gallery of shells and mineralogical specimens, where she sat down to the best breakfast she had enjoyed since leaving home. End of chapter 22.